Sri Jamshed Gadrej, Chairman WRI India, Dr. O.P. Agarwal, CEO, Mrs. Jennifer Lake, Global Director, Energy Program, Sri Madhav Pai, Director, Sustainable Cities, WRI India, delegates who are all participating in this, and my dear sisters and brothers, I am very happy to be with you all today on an important issue which is being championed by an important organization connecting all the people with this ideas of better urbanization and better life. Today, as we gather on this platform, we are looking at one of the major problems facing the world today. We are all together fighting the common challenge of climate change that threatens our planet. And as we brace ourselves to cope up with this challenge, we will have to marshal all our intelligence, knowledge, science, and understanding of nature to do that. Climate change is upon us. Before I proceed further, I am of the view the best way to face the climate change is to be friendly with the nature. Love and live with the nature. Nature, culture, together for a better future. That should be our motto. The reason is, I remember we used to be very nature friendly, and nature also used to be very friendly to us. It rarely used to trouble us. But we are playing with the nature, not caring for it. That's why it's also now playing with us. We must admit this reality. And we must go back to our system. I remember as a student, we used to have different classes in the school. One PT class, physical training, of course, now there's no physical activity because schools are in multi-storied buildings. And you know, it's telling effect on our health also, lifestyle. Second is we used to have a NCC, Air Wing, Navy, other NSS and all. Now they are not mandatory. Third one is we used to have a moral science. Now science remains, morals have been given up. Now we also used to have a craft class. Because India, you know, huge population, they depend on various crafts. And there are a lot of skills available. So there used to be a craft class in the school itself. And we used to be taken to different locations also. And also, there used to be a gardening class. I remember gardening class, we all used to be taken to the backyard of the school and then how to grow vegetables, small flowers, and then all these things we used to be trained to make us nature friendly. But unfortunately, that's no more part of our curriculum. I think we have to go back to our old system. Secondly, as we are all seeing that weather-related disasters have been increasing in frequency and intensity, from wildfires to hurricanes, droughts, flash floods, the world has been ravaged by natural calamities all through last year. India has its own share of disasters in 18 alone. Kerala saw the worst floods in 100 years. In North India, Uttar Pradesh, Rajasthan, and a few other states were hit by massive dust storm. And in Maharashtra, several districts suffered severe drought, even as Mumbai experienced erratic rainfall throughout the monsoon months, from two deluges in June and July to almost a rain. No rainfall in August and September. There were many others, Delhi, and as you have seen, alternative day, transportation, and people wearing masks, children also being advised like that and all. So the challenges are very evident. In view of India's high population density, any disaster in India impacts many more people than it does other parts of the world, India and China. Both of us, we account for a good number of population of the world. So if we take care of these aspects, the problems of the world, the percentage also will automatically come down. We know that India is going to become the most populous country in the world within the next generation. This is an area where, unfortunately, we are not focusing our attention. And some people seem to be enjoying also. The land is the same. Water is the same. The resources are almost same, except knowledge, of course. Knowledge can increase and create a new wealth. But if you go on with this such of a surging population, then what is going to happen to humanity? We have to seriously think about it also, and with the planners, the political leaders, the media, and the public, well-intentioned people, they should all start discussing that aspect also. Somehow I have seen, once I remember as a minister, I went to planning commission, the then planning commission, and then during a discussion, I suggested the same. There was a news item in one of the leading dailies. Mr. Naidu is advocating incentives and disincentives to control population. I don't know what is wrong with that. Incentives and disincentives. Following population control, incentive. Not following population control, disincentive. I don't know. But somehow, we are not, as a nation, we are not focusing. And some in between, I saw some chief minister saying, you know, two children are not sufficient, we must produce more. Okay, we're a democracy, of course. Let the debate go on. But I want a constructive debate on this aspect also. You go to African countries, go to European countries, and see the population there and the resources that are available, the greenery that is there and all. You start envying them. But what is the meaning of envying them by producing more people and not being able to control your population? This is one area I feel personally we must focus our attention. Of course, economy is also growing, but challenges also are growing. And now the latest report says World Bank, World Economic Forum, Asian Development Bank, International Monetary Fund, Moody's ratings, everybody is suggesting that India is likely to become third largest economy. One of our professors was arguing, saying, no, we are already third largest economy. Why are you talking like that? Okay, third or second, whatever it is, but that is the forecast. So that being the case, we have to take care of the living condition of the people, including the climate change. As income grow, people legitimately want better lifestyles. They want bigger houses, more vehicles, more cars, more air conditioning, more energy, and bigger offices. But this also means more urbanization, more energy consumption, more carbon emissions, more waste generation, more air pollution, and higher demand for land. This is the land is limited, as I told you, land is limited. There is demand is going to be more. Urbanization is a reality. You can't reverse it even if you want it also. You can't reverse it. Mahatma Gandhi gave a call after independence. He said, back to villages. But as usual, disregarded Mahatma Gandhi and moved towards, and urbanization has become a reality. Even I have migrated from rural development to urban development as minister. I was minister in rural development during Vajpayee's period. And I was picked up for urban development minister in Narendra Bhai's period. I asked my colleagues, Haribhai, I am an agriculturalist, I am a farmer. And that portfolio I have taken by choice. Why this is given? One of my friends, who is very intelligent, who comes regularly on net and also write blogs, he told me, hey, perhaps the reason is that there's more and more people from rural area are coming to urban area, and you have to take care of them. That's why this is given to you. I have the experience of both rural development and urban development. The problems are many in the urban side. People are coming, but land is limited. And then facilities, transportation, stay, housing, and also the other requirements that are needed, they have to be focused into. This is possible. Several countries which are also have limited natural resources have shown that it's possible to be careful and consciously adopt a low-carbon growth path without in any way compromising on our economic development. It is therefore imperative that we use our natural resources sensibly. To chart out a low-carbon path, we must all try to learn, maximize our resources and not be wasteful in our behavior. Another important point I want to make today is, with all the policies, with all the programs, with all smart cities, with all metros, with all housing, with all Amrut, with all so many other things and all, what is required is there is a need to change the mindset of the people. I am talking more with reference to, with relevance to India. We need to change the mindset of the people. That is very much required. I remember Bill Gates, when he came to meet me as urban development minister, we were discussing about Swachh Bharat, the toilet construction and all. You know, in the recent past, India has gone for a massive toilet construction, both in rural and urban areas. It's a very good program, Swachh Bharat. So he told me, Mr. Naidu, the issue is not of money. The issue is more of a mindset, change up. I realize that unless you change the mindset of the people, all these programs will not succeed. That's why the Prime Minister also, I remember, having told me, he said, Venkaiah ji, these programs, Swachh Bharat, should not be a government program, governmental program, should not be a political program. And then I was wondering, if it is not government and then political, what else it is? He said that it should be made into a people's program. Ek janandolan ka roop dena chahiye. I realize the sensibleness in the advice. Unless people own this, Beti Bachao, Beti Padao, tree plantation, Swachh Bharat, all these programs that are given by the government, waste management and all, they will not succeed because India's size. And also, we have a central government, we have a state government, we have a local government, different parties, different plans, different agendas, and also languages are different, behavior also there are problems, etc. So that being the case, we have to first of all educate our people, even with, for better urbanization also, the civic sense cannot be brought by mere legislation alone. Legislation is required. Strong action is required. Penal action also is required. But at the same time, we have to change the behavior of the people. You have to educate them. That is very much necessary. Later we can go, I was also thinking that persuasion, then education, then legislation, and then penalization and all. People said, go slow on that, penalization. And Singapore, people give the example of Singapore. I also remember when I first time went to Singapore, the guide who was there, he was announcing, saying that, be please careful, don't throw anything outside. You know, anything. Here we have the habit of throwing everything outside, and other outsiders throw everything inside. So they'll be there only. So he was saying, I thought it's a normal caution. Then he added, if you throw something out, waste anything, there will be mobile courts, they'll catch hold of you and then fine you $500. This is in 1979. $500 at that time, $500 was only allowed for us. I thought $500 gone means then what will happen to us? So that Singapore have succeeded because population is small. And also education is high. And the government also admitted. So similarly, there are some other countries also. So, but in a country of India's size, you have to first provide the required guidance, education, propagation, and then also provide infrastructure. Without creating infrastructure, if you say, don't park here, don't park there, and then people will say, sir, where to park first? Tell us. So you have to create parking, public parking, and you have to also provide a public transport. We are now discussing about congestion. I was a minister, I remember, wherever I used to go outside Delhi, and I used to come, I used to take metro from airport to Sivaji Stadium, 18 minutes. No tension, only attention, dispose the files also of the day, enjoy happiness and all. So I used to set up that example so that others also can get encouraged. As a minister, minister of transport, urban minister himself was traveling by metro. Now, of course, metro is the flavor of the season now. Every city wants metro. People are talking about it at all. So we have to bring an attitudinal change in the minds of the people and then also strengthen the laws. And then go for penalization, if any. Mere law, will not suffice. We have seen, and moreover in India, anything you say, people say, sir, bring a new law. But there are enough laws. Some of them need to be put in RQs. The Prime Minister said, dispose of all, as many laws as possible. I think some 1,300 or 1,500 laws have been repealed by this government. I remember there was a discussion that an unfortunate, atrocious thing happened to a girl, Nirbhaya. There was so much clamor, bring a Nirbhaya law, Nirbhaya law. I was a member of parliament, not in the government at the time, I think 2012. I remember having said, Mr. Chairman, what is required is not a new bill. I'm not against the bill. What is required is not a bill. What is required is political will, administrative skill, and then go for the kill of the social evil, I said. You have to educate the people and change. Mindset is changing now. I've been going around as Vice President of India, addressing various universities. In the last 16 months, I have covered around 75 universities, convocations. And I found, to my happiness, that the, you know, Vice President awards the medals. Graduation will be 400, 600, so normally you can't expect the Vice President to stay that much time. So they say, sir, gold medals. First you distribute, other things will be done by the Chancellor or the Governor after the Vice President leaves. So to my happiness, pleasantness, in most of the universities, the gold medals, 65% to 80% are given to girls. Girls, that means it's picking up. The change is happening. In India, I saw it with my own eyes. The other day I was there in one of the universities, one girl got 8 gold medals. 8 gold medals. So if you give an opportunity, woman can excel. That's, once upon a time people used to say, padke karna kya? What is there to do for the girls? She has to stay at home only. That was the thinking. That's not the reality. We have to empower women, and we have seen women, if you empower Indira Nui, you have Arundhati Bhattacharya, you have the latest example of this girl, this lady, Geeta Gopinath. She has become chief economic advisor to International Monetary Fund. So if you empower, if you upgrade the skills, women also can do an excellent job. There are a number of examples. I don't want to dwell on that. So we have to, first of all, educate the people about the dangers of, one, this climate change, carbon emissions, and also growing more greenery and taking care of our surroundings, our own surroundings, waste to wealth. New scheme has been formulated and I was a minister. Waste to energy, waste to wealth. These are two schemes that have been formulated after so much consultation by various ministries, and we should move in that direction. And we should move from private transport to public transport. The importance has to be given to this by all concerned. And in that also, the move is moving to electrical. That is the way forward. And I'm happy the minister, the transport minister, Mr. Gadkari, government is moving in that direction and also preparing plans, and also country also is slowly getting ready to that. Public transport really serves the purpose. So many cars in Delhi, we have, I think, more than population, cars are more than population. Morning one car, evening one car, some people have the habit of doing it. Daughter one car, brother son one car, wife one car, and husband one car. This, where are we going to? And we are not realizing the disastrous consequences, though often we have been cautioned. See, my dear friends, the country is seeing rapid demographic transformation. Urbanization is taking place rapidly from just 62 million in 51. Our cities have had over 377 million people in 2011, as per the last census. The share of the urban population went up from 17.3 to 31.2. It will be somewhere around 35% or 36%. Today, we understand that it has risen even further. According to United Nations, and predictions are that it will exceed 35-36 by the next census. While this is the one way, is a good sign and a manifestation of our shift from being a predominantly agriculture economy to a manufacturing and service sector economy, it also means a need to invest in our cities. Studies have shown that we need to invest over 34 lakh crores in our urban infrastructure in the next 20 years. However, the public budget cannot afford this. Resources have to come from other sources. The private sector will need to invest in a big way. Public-private participation should be encouraged. I'm happy the government is doing it. Private capital has to be tapped by making our investments bankable. The limited public funds has to be leveraged for this. The Smart Cities Mission launched by the government seeks to do preciously the same. The government is only giving 500 crores. The remaining thing, because we have now really brought a lot of reforms. The Prime Minister is speaking about reform, perform and transform. Transformation of the nation in every walk of public life, in every act you do. So that is the way forward. And I'm happy to share with you the public-private partnership model is doing wonderful. Delhi Airport, Mumbai Airport, Bengaluru Airport, Hyderabad Airport, even a lot of other these things also, National Highway, that connectivity which is brought by late Prime Minister Sri Atal Bihari Vajpayee in a big way, that has proved to be a big boon to all of us. So that's the way forward and we should encourage. And we are allowing 100% of FDI. What is the fun of, privatization is not good and all. What is privatization? You are handing over to the people, our own people only. So there is a need for change of mindset in that also. A growing urban population along with growing income has led to rapid motorization. This has meant severe congestion and adversely impacting the economic efficiency of our cities. It has also led to poor air quality and an increasing incidence of road accident deaths. Unfortunately, we are seeing nearly 400 road accident deaths every day, causing untold misery to those who lose their near and dear ones. The growth, the government has been according high priority to investments in public transport system, including metro rail systems. These need to be planned well as part of a comprehensive mobility plan. What is going to be your city in the next 20 years, 30 years, 40 years? Then plan accordingly roads, then plan accordingly public transport, and then you also try to create satellite towns for these cities. This planning is very much required. These need to be planned very well and also as part of a comprehensive mobility plan. Standalone metro systems are not effective and need a holistic approach. Globally, the mobility sector is also witnessing several new paradigms, shared mobility systems, electric vehicles, bicycles and connected vehicles are becoming to occupy the center stage in the global mobility system. India also must follow the same. Cycling serves both purposes. One is that it will improve your health also. Second is, I went to Berlin, I found, I'm told there 13% of the people are attending offices on a bicycle. We have made it out of fashion. Now we have to again bring back. And in Netherlands, and I went there, I saw cycle tracks to the fields, agriculture fields. So we should think on those lines. We must have a cycle track. And then we must also have a pedestrian path, physical activity, also some amount of walking, na? Because life is becoming mechanical. Morning you get up and get on to dining table, eat something, get down, and then get on to your vehicle, and then get down and get on to your chair in the office, and get down and then come back and get on to the dining table, and then get down and then get on to vehicle. Go on like that till evening and come back and then get on to your bed and get down in the morning. Literally, there is no physical activity. Literally. That's the problem. There are two problems that are coming. One is the lifestyle changes. They are adding to the misery of the people, lifestyle. We have to go back to our old lifestyle. Second is food habits also. Food habits. You may be surprised the Vice President of India is giving advice on food. I am not suggesting you should eat vegetarian only or non-vegetarian only. I have been a strict non-vegetarian all these years for your information. But doctors have told me, sir, you have eaten enough. Reduce now. So I started reducing. You must also have noticed it also by my appearance also. Choice is people's. I leave the choice to the people. But eat good food, quality food. That is what is required. That also makes our life healthy. A healthy nation can become a wealthy nation. But there is no guarantee that a wealthy nation can become a healthy nation. Our food system and every country's food system is time-tested according to seasons, according to the local conditions. And we are an old civilization, our forefathers, thousands of years. And then they have prescribed a certain amount of food for that particular region. And we should follow it. Instead of that, now fascination, advertisement, branding, what is called instant food. Instant food means constant disease. This has to be understood by one and all. Food has to be cooked properly. It cannot be preserved for long. This is a wrong theory. You go through the magazines, even developed countries, Western magazines, American, European magazines also. The prevalence of cancer and all is connected to food habits also. And we have, in our country, you know, imitation is the easiest thing and all, publicity and all. You go to this, that and all, you go to restaurants and jokingly I say, the children go to restaurant names, they change the names, chicken 65. Your age is not even 25. You want to eat 65. So that you can become 65 at the earliest. Why? Itna Indian food quality. Best food you have, vegetarian, non-vegetarian in India, variety of food. I have been going to different countries in the recent past. I have been there in Costa Rica, I have been there in Paraguay. Everywhere people are saying, sir, we like Indian culture, we like Indian food also. Indian food. The heads of the states are all saying it. So ours is time tested. So wherever I am going, I am advising the younger generation, please focus your attention on our food. Try to encourage and promote. The other names, okay, they put names, attractive names, chicken, Manchuria. But you have Himalaya here. Why you have what Manchuria, Somalia, Bulgaria? And you have your own good food. Food habits also, and then waste management. Waste management is an important task that has to be dealt by the local bodies. And the local bodies, first of all, has to be strengthened. Thanks to 73rd and 74th amendments, certain amount of focus has been made. Powers, functions and funds has been allocated to the local bodies. 29 subjects were supposed to be transferred to the local bodies. Some of them have been done. Some of them are yet to be done. I have persuaded during my tenure, called a national conference, where I invited Vajpayee and also Sonia Ji also at that time, so that there is broad consensus. And some of the states are yet to devolve the funds and functions. Three Fs, functions, funds, and functionaries has to be transferred. I'm very happy accepting the 14th Finance Commission recommendation. The present government have transferred around 42%, earlier it's 32%, 42% of the funds to states, okay? But they have also transferred 5% of the resources to the local bodies. So the local bodies also should. And local bodies also, there has to be a change of mindset again. The change of mindset is, you know, municipal chairmen, they come and they give memorandum to the minister, state minister. State minister gives memorandum to central minister. Central minister goes to finance minister. Finance minister goes to prime minister. And prime minister has to go to World Bank or what? So you have to raise resources locally. The local body should also raise resources. People say, sir, if you tax, then they will ax you in the election and all. It is not correct. If you tax and collect taxes in a transparent manner, and if you become accountable, people will definitely pay taxes. I have a number of examples. I don't want to take time now. I have another program. I have to catch a flight and go to Hyderabad. That's why I requested them to prepone it by 15 minutes. So, there are a number of examples, but you have to be transparent. I tell you one girl in Andhra Pradesh who has become the chairman of a municipality named Tanuku. She, every street, she has put a signboard, amount of taxes collected in this area, and works that are being carried, estimate, name, publicly. And people are paying perfectly taxes. Nobody was grumbling. But you must have such leadership. And you have to tell them also frankly. I remember as the urban development minister, I used to go around the country, everywhere, memorandum, sir, we want this, we want this, we want this and all. Okay, Babu, what are you going to do? Amara paise to paisa hai nahi, sir. And because fear of taxing means axing and all. So this is another change that has to come. One is the behavioral change and then mental attitude and also revenue mobilization also. There are certain welcoming changes that are happening. and will have impact of reducing traffic congestion. Now the smart cities, cycling is a part of a smart city. Pedestrian paths is part of a smart city. And then growing vegetables in urban areas is also part of a smart city. And also tree plantation in a massive way is also part of a smart city program and all. Going for public transport is also part of smart city. It should not be confined to smart cities. It should be extended to all the cities. We need not wait for the government to declare you as a smart city. Smartness depends on the leadership. Mayor, municipal chairman, or the officer, commissioner of the municipality. Smart do not mean height and weight and coat and boot and suit and hat. Smart in action. Smart in thinking. So you need smart leadership also to bring this transformative change. And then reducing traffic congestion, providing adequate traffic parking spaces. We have to leverage these changes and mainstream them into our Indian mobility planning. We have to also focus on the inland water transportation and utilize the vast river resources we have in our country. Earlier, we used to have inland water transport. Now, again, government is focusing on that. More and more focus that will also reduce congestion and also reduce pollution. Let me turn to the electricity sector. Today, we can rightfully say that the era of shortage in electricity is gone. We are producing enough electricity today. However, we do have the challenge of distribution. Electricity needs to reach the remotest homes, and this has been problematic. Over 200 million people have extremely poor access to electricity in India. Like most other countries of the world, has invested in a big way in coal-based thermal power. Coal-fired power is expensive, unsustainable, highly water-intensive, and contributes to massive air and water pollution. This is an area we have to be very careful. It is imperative that we enhance the share of electricity we generate from greener sources like wind and solar and other things. Sometime back when I was traveling in London, the driver, the chauffeur, told me, "Sir, good morning." I said, "Okay, namaste." He said, "Sir, today is a sunny day, happy day." I said, "Sunny day? Your son's birthday?" He said, "No, sir, sunny day. Sun is bright in London." I told him, "Poor fellow, in India, 365 days are sunny days. We have not enough sun, more sun. More suns also." And now we started focusing on that. Prime Minister took initiative, and along with France, we have formed that solar alliance. A number of countries are joining the solar alliance. You are seeing the thermal power, which was 6 rupees 70 paise per unit, has come down now to 2 rupees 60 paise because of solar. It's a natural resource and biofuel. You have so many other things also. We should focus not only government, private sector, and we have to educate the people also, organizations like this, WRI. They have to create the required awareness. I'm happy they are doing it. The solar and also LED. LED is bringing a revolution in the country. The municipal electricity bills has gone down by 40%, all municipalities. Because the Prime Minister has taken a massive program, and most of the municipalities have replaced the street lights already. Now it must go to extend to houses also. So we must have solar, we must have rainwater harvesting, we must have tree plantation, we must have proper waste management system. In each house, for that the municipal plans approval system has to change. Because as I told you, this change can happen and be successful only if everybody participate. If you leave it to government, sab kaam sarkar karega, hum bekar baithe to chalega, aisa nahi chalega. You have to be also partner of the development. We have taken up an ambitious program to enhance our solar energy capacity. In the 2015 Paris Agreement, India has made an ambitious commitment that by 2030, about 40% of the nation's installed energy capacity would be from non-fossil fuel resources. Our commitment towards renewable energy sources has led to the setting up of the International Solar Alliance, the first treaty based on international government organizations headquartered in India. India's installed solar generation capacity has grown over 10 times in the last 5 years. Today, this sector is creating a new jobs for men and women across India, contributing to the overall GDP of the country, even as we find solutions for the complex problem of clean energy. Ma'am, our air quality has been a matter of concern. This power also, the government has reached now almost every village, but now you have to reach every house. Reaching the village is also a major task. It is happening after 71 years, but now you have to reach every house also. And then replace the present system with the renewable energy. That also should be part of our planning. Now solar, the other day I met one girl who is the daughter of the director of Indira Gandhi Upright Research Institute. She said she has had her master's degree from Pennsylvania University, and then she is promoting a startup on a solar, small solar, where there is no electricity in the rural areas and all. Such innovative ideas need to be encouraged. We need to systematically identify the sources of the problems and deal with them. Otherwise, this will adversely impact the health and well-being of city residents, especially our children. Air quality is a major challenge. Let me now turn to our food systems also. Our farmers are very important. I'm not talking of individual food. Country also has to focus more and more on food security. We are not like Singapore, we are not like Dubai, where they get everything imported. That's why you find Singapore and Dubai, you'll find all colorful, fresh vegetables and fruits also, because they can afford to import because their population is limited. But India size, we can't afford to have a imported food security. We have to develop our homegrown food security. So we have to take care of our agriculture and also see to it that agriculture becomes sustainable. Otherwise, more people are likely to leave agriculture and then come to urban areas and create more congestion. So side by side, while strengthening the urban infrastructure, we have to also take care of the rural people, because agriculture is the basic culture of India. And also food requirement. And not only food, we have now surplus food. We should not be complacent, because even having surplus food, still there is hunger, hidden hunger, hidden hunger. There's a vitamin shortage. You go to doctors, many of people here sitting here, go to doctor, he will tell you D3 deficiency, B12 deficiency. There is a protein deficiency also that is there. So we have to change the food habits, cereals, pulses, the other things, diversification of our crops. This should be part of our larger planning also. And also better market conditions and all. The people in urban area, they have to pay more. And the people in the rural area, they are getting less for their produces. This is another really malady we have to understand. And the solution is enam. Tomato in Madanapalli in Andhra Pradesh is 1 rupee kilo. Bangalore, 8 rupees, 120 kilometers away. And then Delhi, it is around 18 rupees at times. Nasik, where onions are produced, sometimes it's thrown out. And then, you know, in Delhi, one government lost because of onion prices. So you need to provide cold storage, you need to provide refrigerated system, and you need to also open up the market that people from Delhi can order in Nasik. So enam, National Agriculture Marketing System, that sort of system has to be strengthened. So as our land is also limited, we must produce more from the same land. Then the advice of per drop for more crop, that also has to be taken care. And we should measure is not the tons of paddy produced per hectare, but the units of nutrition produced per hectare. So this greater tree cover can improve the use of dry and degraded land and also remove the carbon from the atmosphere. It is for this reason that we have committed to restore 13 million hectares of degraded land by 2020 and an additional 8 million hectares by 2030. My dear friends, many of the challenges we face today need innovative solutions. Business as usual will not work. As a means to promote innovations and encourage young innovators, the government has opened the doors to startups through platforms like Stand Up India, Startup India, Digital India, etc., which will bring smart initiatives on a level platform and encourage innovation. And moreover, delivery system has to be improved. This is one point I want to make. You have to go to taluk office, you have to go to revenue office, you have to go to collector office, you have to go to this office, that office and all. Slowly, we must move towards digitization. We are moving. We must move faster. Everything should be online. so that there's no need to go and stand in a line. Standing in a line, going and meeting the officer, greeting the officer, shaking hand, doing something in between hand, that should not be required. You should, everything should be transferred, compensation, insurance, pension, or scholarship, or any entitlement should be direct, JAM, Janadhana, bank account, Aadhaar card, and mobile. It should reach you so that there's no need to move from one place to another place. That is should be the ultimate aim, and that should be fast forwarded. 250,000 villages are being, optic fiber lines are being laid. That should happen at the earliest. That's one agenda of the government. I'm happy, but we should all support that. The construction area with waste material, utilizing it properly is also a big challenge, and focus is being made on that. We need to focus more and more on that. See, I am very happy that these new technologies are coming that are clean, cheap, and allow quicker construction also. Housing, massive housing government have given so many incentives. Housing is required because we have a huge population, homeless population. So housing has been given incentives in the budget. Lot of tax concessions have been given. Interest rates have been brought down also. That's one of the major push the country need to take. And also, for all these things to happen, there has to be broad consensus on reforms. I'm happy there is consensus. At times, they may posturing may be different by political parties. But broadly, I was Minister for Parliament Affairs during this GST. And I went and met everybody. Everybody said, we are not against. In fact, we started this. People started saying, then you started this, let us end also now. We persuaded at the end of it, we got the GST. And GST is now doing wonders. GST is doing wonders now because the tax base has increased. More people have come into the net. And then tax rate is coming down, 28 to 18, 18 to 12, 12 to 5. We are seeing every meeting, rates are coming down. So such reforms, we have to evolve broad consensus. And we must learn by experience. I can tell you the world is also looking to India. At number of places, wherever I go, they are inquiring about your GST. They are inquiring about this reforms process, the talk of removing the red tape and then having a red carpet for the investors. Ease of approvals, India's this thing has ranking has gone up by the World Bank also. All these things are happening, but they must happen at a much faster pace. That is the point I want to make, because we have a demographic dividend. 65% of the Indian population are around 30, 32 years. They are aspirational. They want quick results. Earlier, people used to wait 50 years, 30 years, 20 years. No, no, sir. 5 years you have been there. What happened? Come on, tell me. So you have to understand the aspirations, and you must come out with quicker solutions and also have answers to the problems of the people. So for that also, you need to create the net atmosphere. And also, all state and central government must work together. You must also learn from experience of others. Wise men learn from others' experience. And there is a saying, fools learn from their own experience. We are all wise men gathered here. We should learn from others' experience, try to know what is happening here, what is happening there, what are the best practices, what are suited to India, and then bring such changes so that you can have a better urban life. At the end of the day, what is the purpose of reforms? Science, technology, innovations, is to make the people's life better. People's life better, happy. What is required is not only prosperity, but also happiness. That's why now the world is talking about happiness index. Developmental index, sustainable development, and then happiness index also. So let us, beyond public-private binary, in our discourse, we should strive to build public-private partnership also, about public welfare through innovative private enterprise also. We are poised to become $5 trillion economy. Our sights are higher to become $10 trillion economy in 8 years thereafter. I'm hopeful and confident that with a wise and stable approach, we can support our burgeoning urban-rural population to live well and with dignity, with access to safe and affordable living spaces, clean air, clean drinking water, healthy and nutritious food, well-networked and equitable transport. We also strive to make India population pollution free again. Climate change is threatening us, but it's also brought many of us together, those who sincerely care about it. So that's why events like WR's Connect Karo, which strive to bring together a variety of stakeholders on the same platform of great value today. finally, I will just would like to say, not only connect Karo, but also correct Karo. First, correct ourselves. Correct the systems. Correct the behavior. So that we can collectively correct our development strategies to include preservation of nature. In the Indian context, the cultural traditions of worshipping nature can provide additional inspiration for concrete, accelerated action. We should love and live with the nature, preserve nature and culture for a better future. This is my advice to all of you. Thank you very much for providing me this opportunity. I would like to compliment the WRA for having such a conclave where you can share your ideas, your experiences, best practices, and then follow it in our respective sphere of activity. Thank you very much. Namaskar. Jai Hind.